Welcome, everyone. Welcome to the second day of the Meal Plan Research Symposium. Thank you for being with us today.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for this opportunity. I am very honored to be here. So today I'm gonna talk to you about the integrating dateline information and genomic prediction tools for predicting days to maturity in soybeans under complex scenarios. So this is a collaboration with Dr. Diego Harkin here at the University of Lincoln, Nebraska. So I'm gonna show you a little bit about the problem of predicting time-related traits when the accuracy is more important than precision. I'm gonna show you some description about the data analysis that we use and a little bit about the model for leveraging the date information in genomic selection and genomic predictions. I'm gonna show you some results and conclusions. You know, there are many important traits that are complex in the sense that are affected by many gene effects. As so far, genomic selection has shown to be a very efficient tool for predicting ranking performance of untested genotypes in unobserved environments. For example, we have traits like grain yield and plant height, where breeders are very interested in selecting those lines that yield the most because of the rankings. However, for time-related traits, perceived values are very important. Usually, when no information for the target environment is available, genomic selection might not be the most efficient tool to use. In these cases, when we want to predict days to heading in rice, days to pollens in maize, or days to maturity in soybeans, maybe we can not use the genomic selections, but there might be some potential implications of using these genomic selections. For example, when we want to predict some stages, we can say flowering stage in soybean, and we predict something else like days to maturity, maybe we will be in adjusting the cropping schedule. So in this case, soybean have many important growing development stages, starting from the planting seed until the reproductive stages where breeders are very interested for selection and considering local adaptations. But let's see what is going on. Usually, genomic selection models can be very precise, but also very inaccurate. If you remember your STAS courses, we have different type of estimators. For example, in A, we have an estimator that is accurate, but is not precise. In the case of B, we have an estimator that is precise because the darts are close together. In case of C, we have an estimator that is accurate, yes, in average, because the darts are close together. And in the case of D, we have an estimator that are precise and is accurate. So again, when we don't have any information for a target environment and we were using genomic selection models, we obtain a result like in B. Anyway, there is nothing that can impede us to using genomic selection models. In those cases, we can get a moderate to high correlation between the predicted and observed values, but we might incur in higher or larger bias. For example, if you want to predict the days to maturity, let's say in soybean, and we got a result of 100 days, when the real value will be 90 days, we will be in a bias of 10 days. These 10 days for days to maturity in soybean will be very critical. In our case, we use data from the Soynam data. So this is a huge soybean experiment that was conducted between 2011 and 2013. Here, 40 biparental parent populations were tested in 9 locations. For each population, there was something like 140 RLs per family, with one common parent, Iowa 323. In this case, there were 9 locations with 18 environments. We define environment like location by year combination. In this study, we consider only 367 genotypes tested in 11 environments. So our goal was to predict the days to maturity, and we define days to maturity as the time needed for the plant to reach the maturity. Also, we use the daily information by a model included in the Geosphere R package. So when we have a data like this in this plot, where to start? One of the first things is try to evaluate if the data we have meet the minimum requirements needed by the genomic selection models to work. As you can see here, there is a huge variability for days to maturity among the different environments. As we know, genomic selection models assume homogeneity or variance between environments, and a violation of this assumption might induce serious inconsistencies in the results. It seems like we won't be able to use the model selections. So now what we can do with this data? One alternative was using information outside of the genomics data. One initial ideas that we use was the daylane, and we consider at the beginning the cumulative daylane information for predicting the days to maturity in soybean. And we obtain a plot like this. It seems like having the cumulative daylane information is very easy to predict days to maturity for any genotype in any environment. This is a very good attempt, but this is a recurrent problem because we need to know first the days to maturity in order to know how many days will be accumulating the daylane information. But not all is lost. It's clear that the lead information provides a strong information about the days to maturity in soybean. The problem is how to leverage this information in the predicted context. As I said before, genomic selection is a very precise tool, but what we can do? However, in the complex scenarios, when we haven't observed any environment in the target environment, the results might be biased. We will be in the situation like this, where or the values are really good, but they are off of the target environment. In this case, we can use the daylane information to correct the predicted values. One of the advantages is that the daylane information can be not in advance, but just knowing the location and the planting date. So here is how we start to develop the model. One of the first things that we thought was, we already observed this genotype many times in other environments, and we decide to study each one of the genotypes at the same time. In this plot, we have in the x-axis the days to maturity, starting for the planting date, and we set up it to zero, the planting date. This plot shows the progression of the daylane from planting date until the day when these genotypes reach the days to maturity, and we represent this with the blue dots. We were able to fit to relate to all the blue dots on the cloud by a third degree polynomial. As I said before, seems like when we have the daily information for any environment in advance, because we can use it like a theoretical values. In this case, the green line represents the daily inform progression for the target environment. And we realize if we find the crossing point between the green and the orange line, we might have an initial estimation of the age to maturity. In this case, we were able to find this intersection and we find the days to maturity for this specific genotype one in this target environment for the 131 days. And the actual value was 129. So the difference was only 2 days. So I'm gonna explain a little bit about how we set up the values in this model. First, suppose that there is available information of 100 genotypes in the model training. Also, we analyze each one of these genotypes in the training set one at a time. The previous method allow us to estimate the days to maturity for an unobserved genotype in a target unobserved environment. If we repeat the C method or one of the 100 genotypes, we will estimate the values of days to maturity in this target environment. So the next step is just to find the potential days to maturity, the environmental means, E means for the unobserved environment by computing the means of these 100 values. So an accurate and precise prediction of days to maturity for those genotypes in the testing set can be achieved by adding the environmental means on the target environment and the blobs derived from the conventional genomic selection models. The days to maturity estimations are derived from the blobs, but centered on the environmental means. So in this case, we consider two different type of validations. One we call the C method, where we are predicting already tested genotypes in unobserved environments. And the most difficult one was the C method blobs, where we are trying to predict untested genotypes in untested environments, also known as CV00. And we consider three different statistics for assessing the model, the root mean square error, when we try to reduce the bias as much as possible, and the difference between the observed and predicted mean environmental values and the Pearson correlation. So here we got some results, and we have for the CV0 scheme, where we are predicting already observed genotypes in unobserved environments, the root mean square was almost 11 days, and the difference between the observed and predicted mean environmental values varied minus 19.2 and 12 days. With the new method, we reduced this root mean square error to 4.7 days, and the difference of the observed and predicted environmental values was minus 3.3 to 4.6 days. So in here, we have the scatter plot for predicted and observed days to maturity, and we have the results for the proposal model at the top and the bottom of the conventional genomic selection. It is very clear that we fit with the new model. In the right panel, we have the environmental means in orange and the blue dots with the conventional means for the genomic selection. As before, for the most complex scenario, we got our root mean square error of 9 days. The difference between the observed and predicted environmental values was 8 days. So with this new model, we reduced the root mean square error to 5 days. And the difference between the predicted mean environmental values was minus 3.3 to 4.5 days. As said before, in this case, we have a better fit using the new model, and we show at the right panel in blue the results for the environmental means using the genomic selection and in orange using the conventional model. So in conclusion, we can say that we develop a set of models for effectively perform prediction and time-related traits already tested and untested genotypes in the target environments, minus plus 4 days. We think that potentially this could help breeders to schedule the crop season better. And we showed that an important proportion of the genotype by environment interaction can be easily explained using the photoperiod data. The proposed methods show that daylight information significantly helps to improve the predictability in days to maturity in soybean in unobserved environments. And this information can be obtained in advance because you only need to know the location and the planting date. No need to wait to observe all the environmental conditions. So this is all I have. Thank you so much for your attention. I am happy to answer some questions you have.
Thank you, Reina Persa, for your brilliant talk. We don't have any questions already in the chat, so we want to wait a few more minutes. What I was wondering is if your models are already being applied with any farmer, or that already you have the contact with the farmers to test the model?
Yes. Also, we did a similar study in rice in Japan, and there is a paper already published. It was in 2020, I think. Yeah, we got a good results to predict 10 days to heading.
We don't have any questions. Oh, we have one. Would junior method work well in low latitude locations? Not a lot of latitudinal variation.
I think it will work for sure. Yes.
That is because you are testing in several latitudes. So you are
Yes, they are testing in several latitudes. In this case, we use nine locations. There were Illinois, Ohio, Iowa. I don't remember very well the location, but yeah, we are testing different. Also in Japan, you know, there are different, we test in rice from different, the south to the north part, and it works very well.
Thank you, Reina Persa.
Thank you so much for the invitation.
Doing your research.